Okay, this is part three of our videos for simulations using Simulink. We're going to pick up where we left off and move into and also simulate another system, one that's got some nonlinearities in it. So, excuse me, I always do this. There we go. So, remember our first simulation? It was the classic spring mass damper problem, and we built the simulation, and it looked like this. And I just want to kind of run this through again, so you can remember what it is. Remember, the key to the simulation is the integration. So the acceleration is on this line here, as I'm pointing to. We integrate it once, get velocity, integrate again, get displacement. This is a gain factor, multiplies the signal in front of it by 1 over mass. And so what we have here on this signal, and the outcome of the summation, is the summation of forces. So this summation, this gain block, and then these integrations is really an expression of Newton's second law of motion. These feedback loops, these are naturally, we sometimes call these naturally occurring feedback loops. This is part of the structure of the physics. The velocity is multiplied times b to get the damping force, the displacement times k to get the spring force. The summing junction brings these together. The minus sign there implies that they come together as a minus sign. So we have minus bx dot minus kx. So how would we change this then if we wanted to include an external force? Remember what we saw in the last video was just how it responded to initial conditions. We could change the initial conditions. We can have an impulsive force, which is a like beginning with an initial velocity, or we could have an initial displacement and see how it responded. In this case, we want to have a force, either like an actuator on it, or maybe we're pushing on it with our fingers, depending on what kind of a system it is. Well, again, this is the summation of forces, so it adds another force here. We could go ahead and rederive the equations of motion, and I encourage you to do that, but I think we'd all jump ahead and see this is the damping force, this is the spring force, and there's another force that would go in right there. So let's bring up Simulink and the spring mass damper, which I have here, and let's bring up the Simulink library, which I have here. Okay, so I need to change the summing junction so that it has three ports instead of just two, and that this port, the third port, has a plus sign on it. So I'm going to double click on this. And I'm going to just, so this has a bar, which is actually is a space in there, that vertical bar in the dialog box here. I don't know if you can see it. I can barely see it on my screen. But the bar just kind of moves things around the circle just to make for a neater block diagrams. It really has no meaning to the structure of it. So I want a plus sign and two minus signs. So I'll say plus, minus, minus. And it kind of messed up this a little bit. I got to take this out of here. And if I want to delete a line, you just highlight it, click on it once, hit delete, and it's gone. So this is pretty much what I wanted. I crossed these two lines. Let's clean it up a little bit. Crossed lines are really not a problem, other than the fact that they're sometimes ambiguous. See, these lines here are connected. See, there's a little full circle back here where we tap off the signal. But lines sometimes cross, and it can be confusing if somebody doesn't know what they're looking at. So we'll try to get rid of the crossed lines. So I want to have a force input, and I've got to define it somehow. And I'll go to my sources diagram, and I'll use the step input, and that's it down here. Just drag it onto the other window and connect it up. So it's really literally that simple to put an external force on here. Let me open this up. There's several things that determine the step. It's what time, t equals 1 in this case, is the time at which the step executes. And then you can have the initial value and the final value. So in this case, it'll step from a value of 0 newtons to 1 newton at time t equals 1. I'm going to make it t equal 5 to make it run a little bit longer. We have here the same simulation we started with. The mass is 1, the damping factor is 1, the spring constant is 1. There's an initial velocity of 1 meter per second, and we're ready to go. And we're going to run for 10 seconds. So it's going to run, thinking about it. There's that thunking noise that it makes when it's done. Let's open up the scope. Let me show it to you here. Okay, so what are we looking at? Let's do an autoscale here. So remember before it had an overshoot and then an undershoot and then it settled down, right? And then by 10 seconds it was getting pretty close to being done. But here at 5 seconds we got hit with a step, right? And so now it has another response that's going through, and it's gonna settle down to a different location. Let's minimize that. Bring this back and say, well, I don't want to go 10 seconds. I want to go 25 seconds. I want to see more of the response. And indeed, there's the response. Okay, so here's the initial response. Here's 5 seconds. There's my step. And now, actually, that looks like a classic step response, doesn't it, for our system. This is interesting. Here, look at these sharp edges here. Here, these corners in the response, those are, we call those artifacts. They're not really, the response doesn't really do that. The graphing program within MATLAB draws a straight line between two points. And what we're seeing is that the integration algorithm is pretty far, has pretty long step sizes here. They're pretty far apart between output points. That might cause us some problems. In other words, I'd be a little concerned about that. So let's get into the one part of simulations we didn't talk about last time. Well, so let's go down. Remember, there's those 6 areas of simulations. There's the structure of the model itself. In this case, the block diagram we're seeing. There is the initial conditions. I'm a little nervous because the computer's making noises. There's initial conditions, which we talked about in here. There's parameter values, mass, spring constant, and damping factor. There is the inputs. In this case, the first simulation we did didn't have an input. This does have input. Now it's our forcing function here. There's outputs. That's the oscilloscope. And then finally, the sixth component, we didn't talk about this last time, was run control parameters. How do you tell the simulation package to execute this this simulation? We only handled one of those things, and that's the final time, right? That's when we tell the simulation to stop. But if we go here into this little gear and go model configuration parameters, which is sort of a funny word. That's not the one I would have chosen, but you know, the people who write MATLAB didn't ask me that. This is the window that pretty much tells you everything you need to know about. In this case, it's the solver. There's other things you can do here, but what we really want to talk about is the solving of the system. Start time is 0. In this case, 25 seconds is where I started and where I stopped. These are a bunch of entries that tell the MATLAB and Simulink how to solve the differential equations. The default is a variable step size algorithm with a fourth and fifth order solver called the Dorman-Price solver. There's other ones here. There's they don't have the old Runge-Kutta because these are just better algorithms. You can set minimum maximum step size as it's adjusting the step size. And the way it figures out how to make the step size smaller or larger is that it's constantly estimating an error. And you'd have to get into the numerical methods of this to see how it does that. But when it calculates the error, it compares it against the tolerance level. And if the error is too big, it takes a smaller step. And here's the main tolerance level, 1 part in 1,000, 1 × 10⁻³. Let's tighten it up. I'm going to say 1e. -6. Okay. And I'll just say okay. Now remember how fast it ran last time. Now it's gonna have to take smaller time steps to meet that error tolerance. Let's see if we can tell if it took any longer to execute. Not much. Sounded pretty much the same. It might have been a little slower. Let's see what we ended up with. And sure enough, look, there's much smoother lines here. And I think we're feeling a little more confident about the results here. So we get this beginning input, this response to the initial velocity, and then it settles down at 5 seconds. It gets the step input and overshoots there. Okay. Now before we go on, let's just experiment with this a little bit more. Last time I think we changed the K factor. Let's change the mass. Let's make it heavier, and let's make it 5 instead of 1. So it's a heavier mass, springs the same, the force is the same, the damper is the same. What do you think is going to change? Well, we know the mass is goes into the natural frequency. It talks about how fast things are going. The more massive it is, the slower it's going to be. So we'd expect the slower response, and we would also expect, I think, a less damped response. So let's remind ourselves what we looked at here. It went through this almost this full half cycle. It was turning around again by 5 seconds, and by 10 seconds it was coming back down again, and by 15 seconds it settled down almost completely. Okay, so with a mass 5 times as big, oh, and let's remind ourselves of the scale. So it got to a 1 meter deflection here. Okay, so sorry about that. There we go. Let's hit the run again. So there it ran again. Let's pull up that scope. Huh, that looks a lot different, doesn't it? Look at that. Okay, it still went to one here. But that first response is much smaller. It didn't go nearly as high. And I was wrong. It's much more heavily damped this time than it was last time. No overshoot here at all. Much crisper response. That doesn't look right. Oh, and there's the problem, okay? That block is 1 over the mass, not the mass. So what was originally in there was 1 over 1, right? So if I want to change the mass, make it 5 times bigger, it should be 1 over 5. I had 5, which means it's about a point, mass of 0.2. I made it a fifth as light, so I made it much lighter, which means it would be less damped. It would go faster. So let's make that change. 11, when we make mistakes too. Okay, and we can learn from them. We call those teachable moments. Okay, there it is. That's what I was thinking about. Okay, so look what happened here. The initial response got us to 1.6. We have this, the step happened at 5 seconds, but look how long it took to respond. There's more inertia involved here, and it didn't go up nearly as far. And it's settling out, taking much longer to settle out. So it is, relatively speaking, it is less damped. Now, the damping factor, the damper didn't change, but because it's higher mass for that same damper, it's relatively less damped. Let's just, for the heck of it, see what the whole response looks like. Oh, we run it for 50 seconds. It's taking longer. I don't know what was going on there. So there was that overshoot. Now it overshot a lot further last time. It still settles out to 1 meter, but now this first overshoot's much higher because the initial velocity was 1 meter per second. But with a higher mass, there's more energy, right? It's 1/2 mv². So there was 5 times as much energy in this to start with, so it had a lot more to dissipate. At 5 seconds, the step actually comes in right here, but boy, you don't see much of a much. It didn't impact it very much, and it sure took a lot longer to settle out. Again, as I mentioned before, this is a linear system. You can go into the linear differential equations and do all the solutions and figure this out and predict that. So this is completely consistent with what you could do with just pencil and paper. What I really want to show you is how you can use Simulink to solve things you can't solve analytically, you can't solve with pencil and paper, because they're so terribly nonlinear. And nonlinear systems are all around us, but some are more nonlinear than others. So let's look at this system. You might have seen it. We've got one of these somewhere lying around the engineering college. The electrical engineers have it most of the time. It's a magnetic levitation experiment. To give you a sense of scale, this is a benchtop unit. That sphere there is a steel ball bearing. It's 1 inch in diameter, so it's a pretty good sized chunk of steel. That is just what it looks like, a big copper coil, and it's just in a metal frame. There's a little post here that this ball will sit on, but as you can see in this picture, there's a space between the post and the ball, and it is indeed levitating. It's being suspended in midair, where the gravity that wants to pull the ball down is being completely counteracted by the electromagnetic force of the coil. Pretty straightforward. More schematically, it looks like this. I just represented the coil as a cylinder, and then the ball hangs below it. This is an electric circuit. There's a power amplifier that'll apply a voltage on here that'll push current through the coil. The coil itself has a resistance as well, in addition to this discrete resistor out at the end of it. So this RC and the RS are in series. And in fact, that since it's a coil, it also has appreciable inductance. So for analyzing the circuit, we've got an inductor, a resistor, and another resistor. The ball is just a mass. We'll measure x kind of an unusual way. We're going to measure it x equal to 0 being at the bottom of this electromagnetic coil, and we're going to go downward positive. The reason we do this is that the nonlinearity involved here, its simplest expression is if we use this as reference and use this direction downward positive. Any other way, it makes it a little nastier to deal with mathematically. So let's make our life easier. So it's a steel ball with mass m. So developing the model is pretty straightforward. The electric circuit, so you use Newton, Kirchhoff's voltage law to add up the voltage drops across the circuit, and Newton's second law to develop the equation for the mass. And you end up with these two differential equations. The applied voltage to the coil is equal to the sum of the voltage drop across the coil, the voltage drop across the discrete resistor, and the voltage drop due to the inductance. That's the L dI/dt term. This is mass times acceleration. And remember, downward is positive in our reference frame, so mg, the weight, is downward. And this term here is the model of the electromagnetic force, some constant, K sub I, times the ratio of I, the current in the coil, divided by x, the distance from it, and then you square that. So this is nonlinear, and I mean, this first equation is nicely linear. The second equation is nonlinear because you've got two variables in a product form, and you've got a square as well. So between those two things, it's pretty darn nonlinear. So let's go to Simulink. Let's put together a Simulink diagram for this system. Okay, and as we saw the last time, if you solve for the derivative, or the highest derivative in these equations, it's a good start. So the dI/dt is equal to 1 over L times the applied voltage minus that drop across the two resistors in series. And then the acceleration is equal to g minus this k over m now. I just divided through by m, times I over x quantity squared. Pretty straightforward. We don't have to combine them. We don't have to do any more algebra. Just leave them the way they are. And we'll go to simulate, but this is what we'll see. We'll see an integrator for the current. So this top part is the electric circuit. Here's RC plus RS feeding back. There's the coil voltage. There's 1 over L. So here's current. Here is the integrations for the mass. Here's acceleration here. Integrated to velocity, integrated to position. Here's the g coming in here. So we have, remember from our equation before, g minus ki over m times that ratio squared. And what we have in here is one of many ways we can use Simulink to represent this operation. So we have I divided by x, so that's that ratio. And this is a block from the Simulink library. And it's just what it looks like. Something comes in here is multiplied, something here is divided. So here we have that ratio of I over x on this line, and we want to square it. Well, there's probably a function that you can use to square it, but you can use this multiplication box, which just like this one, only both sides multiply. So you have this times this, which is essentially the square of that signal. And then you multiply this by k sub I over m, and you add that in there. So it's pretty straightforward. So let's go to Simulink. There it is. Now we're in Simulink. There's the maglev. Now, before we can run this, we have to set the parameters and initial conditions. And in this case, initial conditions take on a lot of significance. And we'll talk. I think we'll see this as we move along a little bit more. But let me show you one thing I did here. In the block diagram itself, I embedded not numbers but symbols. In this case, 1 over LC. And in this case, k sub I over m. Now I did this because when I change a parameter, I don't have to dig down into the gain functions. And you'll realize, remember the mistake I made with the spring mass damper system? Instead of 1 over m, I just put in a 5 thinking that would be the mass. if I encode this symbology in the game and then change the symbols in the MATLAB environment in the workspace, then we take that source of error totally out of the equation. Didn't intend to do that, but like I said, that's a teachable moment. Same thing with the initial conditions. I gave the initial conditions as a symbol. So that's I0 for the current, V0 for that, and X0 for that. Okay. So before I run this, I actually have to run a script in MATLAB that will set values for these parameters. And then when I hit go on this simulation, it looks into the workspace of MATLAB, sees if these are all defined. If they are, it takes their values, copies it into the Simulink workspace, and runs. And I want to make that clear. It only looks at the value at the beginning, at time t equal to 0. If something else is going on in MATLAB that changes those values, or your simulation could actually change those values, it won't affect the simulation. Okay, so it's whatever the value these variables had, and I'm using the variables, the MATLAB variables that you've assigned to the parameters, whatever values they had at time t equals 0, that's what the simulation will pick up. It's been 20 minutes. I try to keep these a little short. So let's come back to this in part 4 of the simulation. Thanks.